Good morning.
We are in live now.
Yes, thank you very much, dear Rajkumar sir. Again, happy morning to all the participants, students from Malawi, students from Zambia. Today, this webinar journey actually. Today, again, an inspiring day for every one of us, because the session, what we have discussed yesterday, was about the qualities, traits for a winning employment, for a winning employee. And today, we are going to discuss something about the qualities and the traits of a winning entrepreneur. Yesterday, we have discussed something about, cultural fit as well as the modest way. There are two things we have discussed actually. What do you mean by entrepreneurship is making yourself towards the modest way. After globalization, the chances are open to everybody of this universe actually. So the opportunities are in a greater side. Why don't we people are not coming forward to become an entrepreneur? Usually when we are speaking with the engineers, we used to say you should not be a job seeker and you should be a job provider. That much of potential is available in this entrepreneurship journey. Then why many of us are reluctant to take a part of that an important journey is we are afraid of, we are having fear of doing something. Here, again, our, how can I say again, the young successful entrepreneur, he was already with you for one session speaking on cash flow quadrants. Now today, his second session, I welcome on behalf of St. John the Baptist University as well as St. Eugene's University, Mr. P. Grayson Tony, a young entrepreneur. He is a more apt person for giving today's, for handling today's session. Because as an entrepreneur who is having all modest values and technical values within himself. Now, I don't want to take much of my time, my dear participants. I welcome on behalf of you, Mr. P. Grayson Tony, again, and I'm straight away handing over the session to you.
Hi, guys. I hope you are having a great day out there, and hope I'm audible either. So, thanks for the kind words, Mr. Anthony. It's my pleasure doing this out. And he mentioned me successful. I don't know if I'm successful yet because I'm still in the process of pursuing my desires towards entrepreneurship. So I'm sure, like, hope the sessions went on fine overall. All the sessions which you went through was helpful either. And give me a minute for me to share my screen. And to start off, today's session is going to be the traits that will decide a successful entrepreneur. So it's going to be again more about self. The previous session which I had was again about self, and today's session is also going to be about self. So let's get in to the topic. So to start with, entrepreneurial traits. To start off with this, I wish to gives you an idea about what entrepreneurship really is. It's the process of starting and running one's own business. So it's like, it's about owning a system. It's about owning something of your own, as in you will be creating the process. You will be the start and end of the process. You will be taking the process ahead. The whole process setup itself will be created by you, and also you will be taking people through the process. Although you will start alone, you might end up with people, or you might start as a team, but at the end of the day, the process is all yours. So, right, it's the person who is going to pursue this process of entrepreneurship. Whenever there is a word coined entrepreneur, there is essentially going to be some risk involved. And in the previous session, sorry about the Q&A, like we couldn't have a Q&A, like solid Q&A session, but today I'm sure of having a solid Q&A session before closing off. So you can sure post in your doubts, all what you have. And I could see we have more of people interested in agriculture, and also it's no surprise because Malawi is an agricultural backed country. You have tea and tobacco, the maximum cultivated and exported. Getting back to the topic, entrepreneur. So there will be some risk involved. You will be creating something, you will be organizing things, you will be organizing whatever you create or whatever is already there. And at the end of the day, you will be owning it. But to start with, you will actually be owning it to create it and also to organize it. So this is a detailed definition about an entrepreneur. One other word, like similar to risks, whenever there is going to be a term entrepreneur, there is again going to be something innovative, like something creative, something which is not actually there, which is going to be original, which is going to be real. And every time an entrepreneur is going to solve a problem, which is going to improve the standard of living of the society, that is where the entrepreneur gets his priority. Like whenever he finds a way to get people's lives better, he is sure of pursuing that as a track. For instance, take the case of Facebook. In case of Facebook, he was plotting the problem of networking among individuals, networking among people within his university to start with. Although it was a fun thing he started off, but later on he could plot the potential of the particular idea which he pursued. So every time, all this will start as a small idea. Like when it comes to agri, like you might have a smaller idea in plowing or tilling, or you might have something in cropping, or you might have something in bringing out hybrids, genetically engineering the crops, or you might have a cross domain idea of bringing in computer data analytics into agriculture, or you might have something with remote sensing in agriculture. But at the end of the day, it will be a one-line problem that you will be solving. And so whenever there is an idea, you just have to nurture the idea. You have to start off with the particular idea, and you have to give it your thought in order to evolve the idea. And you should make sure that it improves the standard of living of the people in order to position yourself. Although it might sound so empathetic and so undiplomatic to say that finding your position, but it is essential to find your position in order to position your idea that will eventually solve the problem. And by ways and means, you will actually be benefited economically, and in turn the society will also be supported, and they'll be having a better standard of living through your innovations. Now there is a basic doubt among people, like more often they hardly have it as a doubt, but there is a critical difference between being a businessman and an entrepreneur. And it is essential to understand why is it what it is about being a businessman and what it is about being an entrepreneur. When it comes to a businessman, there will be an existing idea and he'll start off with it. He'll be following all the traditional methods of business. There wouldn't be much of risk involved. Like, he'll not be trying anything new. He'll be going off with the traditional ways of doing business. So it's like he'll be in a better position to approximate and predict the happenings. And the profit will also be approximated and predictive. So you'll be like very much calculative about the happenings of daily happenings of your process. So I'll give you an example of a business versus an entrepreneur. Consider a grocery shop in your place. When it comes to an entrepreneur, he'll be there are two ways of becoming an entrepreneur. One is you'll be exploring something really new. The sector itself can be new. For instance, in these days, AI is actually becoming a sector from being a technology. Similarly, you might come out with something that could actually become a sector eventually, but you will start off with it as a smaller idea. Idea eventually becomes a sector. And this particular idea that strikes your mind will go on to be a way bigger idea than you actually think. It'll impact a lot of people's lives. So, for instance, if you take the case of Google, or even the case of Facebook, when they started, they never knew it will impact so many people's lives. Approximately there are 3 billion people using Facebook. But initially, when they started off, there were only 30 people who started using the particular app, the Face Mash, which Zuckerberg started off with. And the idea was very primitive. He didn't evolve much on the idea. But when he went on to explore the possibilities and scope of the particular idea, he came out with Facebook. In that case, risk taking is very much essential. You'll actually be setting your own path. There'll not be any kind of traditional path which you can walk through. You'll not have a time frame set. You have to set your own time frame. You have to set the process. You have to set the elements of the process. In fact, at times you will actually be in a position to explore what the elements could be in the process. And even when it comes to convincing people, be it the customer or be it the team member which you want to have with you working on it, they'll hardly have any idea of what you're talking about. And trust me, that will remain till they breathe their last. Even till you breathe their last, no one is going to understand the idea the way you understood it, because you will be giving so much of thoughts into it. So when it comes to a normal business against an entrepreneurial idea business, convincing people is really hectic. So neither people, nor profit, nor process, nor system, nothing of it will be oriented. You will be in a position to orient all of it, explore all of it, create all of it, set everything in place, and everything will happen incrementally. It's not like you will be setting up things initially and then you will actually setting up a framework and then moving on, but everything will happen incrementally. And when it comes to a businessman, he'll be a player. Consider Malawi, the very city which you belong. There will be a number of grocery shops. So everyone will be considered as a player. But when it comes to a different idea that is being experimented, he'll actually become a market leader. As in, he'll be pioneering the particular way out, and there will be no one ahead of him. And people will actually take his paths to become a market player eventually. And whoever is doing something which is already been done by an entrepreneur, they'll eventually become businessman and they'll be market players. So that's the basic difference between businessman and entrepreneur. There is one other class of people, the industrialists. So when it comes to, I have not included that in the slide, but my intuition says that I have to give you a word about industrialist as well. So when it comes to an industrialist is a person who is involved in manufacturing something. When it comes to a grocery shop, he is a mere distributor of the produced goods. All he has to do is receive the supplies and just distribute it among the people, his stakeholders, and gain a profit out of it. But when it comes to an industrialist, he'll be involved in manufacturing something. Like he can involved in manufacturing of oil, or he can be a producer of cashews. To give you a better understanding, all the agriculturists, all the farmers in your city, they are industrialists in a smaller scale. Like you might think that more often they think that industrialists are often very big, huge in size. They have loads and loads of money with them. But to be exact, industrialists are people like even agriculturists are industrialists in a smaller scale, because they are involved in manufacturing of goods. So it's actually a subclass of business. But not all industrialists are not all businessmen are industrialists, but all industrialists are business people. So I hope when it comes to an industrialist, there are again two classes of industrialists. One can be a businessman and one can be an entrepreneur. An industrialist who is going to be a businessman, he'll actually know the product. For instance, all the agriculturists will come under the class of business people, because they know what is going to happen. They know the climate. They know the supply of water that is available there, the kind of soil that is available there, the resource they have to get the process done of cultivating something. But when it comes to an entrepreneur, consider a person who is involved in producing a new thing. For instance, take the case of Steve Jobs, the founder of Apple. So he is actually an industrialist who comes under the class of entrepreneur. So his idea was, he came out with a new chipset idea, new interface idea, the whole system of embedding of the integrating of hardware and the software was wholly different in his case. And he kept on innovating things, and that's how we went on. So he'll be coming under the class of entrepreneur, but he's still an industrialist, because he was involved in the manufacturing of mobile phones and systems, iPods and MP3 players. So next in line, this is to give you a better picture. A businessman is one who is, I hope you are able to see the first image, that is a watermelon. If a watermelon is sold as it is, like it's just being cut and sold, that is a common process. It's quite common. Like when you're going to buy about 10 watermelons, you will actually know how many pieces can be cut out of those 10 watermelons. And you also know for how much it is sold, because you are not the first person to try something like that. Like there will be loads and loads of people who's into it. And you can actually calculatively know, like if it is going to be 10 watermelons which you are going to buy, you will be buying it at $10, and you can sell it at $15, like $1.5. 50 cents will be the profit out of one watermelon. So that is pretty much calculative. But when it comes to an entrepreneur, he'll not sell it as it is. Like just cutting and selling is not going to work. He'll actually try to make out some juice out of it, or a peculiar watermelon salad, or a peculiar watermelon cross dish. Like it can be a side dish of some of your main dish, or it can actually be a chocolate that can be made out of watermelon. It can be a candy, or it could actually be something that can be built on from watermelon. Like the shell of it can be used to construct something. So when it comes to an entrepreneur, he'll be innovating, he'll be going in detail of the elements involved in the particular process. So when it comes to the watermelon, he's actually going in detail about what all could be done with regards to the watermelon and the people, like in what all forms it could be given to the people. Similar example is banana. Like when it comes to banana, you know the market, you know how much it costs, how much it could be sold for. But when it comes to an entrepreneur, he'll be trying something new. That could be a juice, or it could be an energy drink, it could be a protein powder that could be cultured out of banana. So all these are possible innovations that you can include in the process. So additionally, I'll also give you an idea about, contextually, I'll give you an idea about your scenario. I could see that the highest of producers that is being traded from Malawi abroad, and I don't remember exploring much of Zambia, but three common things that is often exported from African countries to other nations includes, one is the basic thing is tea, number two is tobacco, and number three it's going to be cashew. So the advantage you have is you, and one advantage of being in African countries is that you have loads and loads of opportunities, because you are still developing and the people are still unaware of a lot of processes going on. I'm in the common crowd, so whatever you bring new is going to stand in the market, and you are going to be a market leader that way. So when it comes to these three products, like if it's going to be tea, or if it's going to be tobacco, or on the other hand, if it's going to be cashew, you can, like the current market trend is that the tea will be pruned, dried, it will be sold. It will be classified, graded, and it will be sold. That is the normal way of doing it. But you can pioneer ways out of tea, like you can sell ready-made tea, or you can sell medicine made out of tea. You can find the possible ways of bringing out culturing something out of tea, or you can find efficient ways of producing it. You can find efficient ways of processing it. Like you can find your entrepreneurial idea could be in the process of pruning tea, or it could be in the process of grading tea. So it could be universally explored, and you can potentially be a market leader in that case. And similarly, even in case of tobacco, I'm not unaware of the process, but it goes like there'll be it'll be taken off, it'll be dried off, and it'll be sold. And at times it'll be crushed and ground. You can innovate that process as well, and you can find ways of innovating within the tobacco market itself. And one other process is cashew. Cashew is like, initially you have to know all these processes in order to get ahead with what could actually be done with the particular commodity. This is, I'm talking about industrialists who are entrepreneurs, like entrepreneurs who are industrialists. On the other hand, industrialists who are businessmen, like you can continue doing the same process. You can bring in small innovations and creativity within the process that is happening in the current trend, and you can do it better as well. That is again going to be fruitful. So I hope I gave you a clearer idea about the difference between businessman and entrepreneur. Now you might think, like, why am I getting vast into businessman, entrepreneurship when the topic is just about entrepreneurial traits? Very often it's misunderstood with the traits of being a businessman and being an entrepreneur. For being a businessman, it doesn't take much, but for being an entrepreneur, it takes quite large of things to get ahead in the process of entrepreneurship. So I'll explain details in the successive slides. Right. So most of you might not be aware of this particular topic, the Red Ocean Strategy and the Blue Ocean Strategy. So, I'm sure you are able to position where the businessman is and where the entrepreneur is. Usually the business people, they lie in the Red Ocean Strategy, and entrepreneurs, they lie in the Blue Ocean Strategy. There will be a market ready. There is an existing market when it comes to a red ocean strategy, like the case of a grocery shop. You'll actually be using the traditional methods of marketing the particular idea. Like you might have discount coupon code circulated among the people, or there will be word of mouth that will be circulated among the people. There will be friends and relatives of the particular shop owner who will have a word of mouth to spread things out, and the whole process, like he'll be begging for reader attention. It's not like there will not be much of wow factor in the particular process that is going to happen. It's just going to be an essential idea that will support the individual with a essential thing that is going to happen. And in case of red ocean strategy, the growth is very much slow or pretty much stagnant. It's like you have to spend over years and years of time to reach to a height where you can think of additional businesses. But when it comes to a blue ocean strategy, you're going to set up a whole different market, a whole different set of people who are going to use it, and almost the whole of the population might be interested in your idea. In this case, you don't have to market it much, but you just have to informate them about what your idea is all about. So it's like if you're going to market it 10 times when it's going to be red ocean strategy, you just have to market it twice. Like you just have to informate them about the idea and what the uniqueness of the idea. So that will be a wow factor in the particular strategy which you are going to follow. So you might think, like, is it necessary to come out with a whole new idea to start off with the business? Not necessarily. You might have an idea. You have to nurture the idea, and you have to plot ways that are innovative. So I'll just give you a picture. Like I said already, when it comes to cultivating of tea, you can again involve in the process of cultivating tea and trading tea, but you can bring about changes in the process that is happening. In case of pruning the tea, you might you might end up using a robot, or when it comes to watching over it, you might use a drone, or when it comes to pesticiding the particular crop, you might use drone as well. So these kinds of innovative approaches towards the processes itself is going to be in the blue ocean strategy. Let me tell you how. So I'll just give you a number. When it's going to be cultivating tea, consider you're having some 10 people working for it, and they are going to involve in the process of spraying the pesticides, or they are going to involve in the process of watching over what is happening. In the whole process, you'll have all the 10 people involved, and you'll actually be spending a lot of resources on them. But you can replace either human resource, or you can replace some part of the process with a simpler process that will not cost much of your resource. Like you might speed up the process, or you might end up spending lower money on the process, or you might end up skipping a process which will actually get you a better profit. So that way you can still innovate in a red ocean business idea, and you can push it to the blue ocean idea. So it's like you will be free from competition that way, because all your competitors will be involved in spending so much resource on a particular process, but you'll actually comparatively spend lesser resource on the process, but the output can be same, or it could be better. Like you can use a hybrid variety of crop for tobacco that will give better yields. But whenever you're going to try out something new, you should be in a position to approximate the consequences. That is very much essential. Trying out the blue ocean strategy, this is the risk I am talking about. More often what people do is that they'll not be in a position to approximate what the risks are going to be, and what the possible negative consequences that will result from the particular innovation which you are going to try off or pull off. But it is very essential you try to understand what it is. You have to set a time frame. Like for instance, if you are going to try something new, you have to predict of what it would look like after 10 years. Even after 10 years, if it is going to prove to upgrade the standard of living of the people, this particular line, like it should enhance the life of the people, it should constantly do that, and it should consistently be a process that enhances the lives of the people. You should ensure that. That prediction should be done whenever you're going to try out the Blue Ocean job. And the main advantage of being in a Blue Ocean strategy is that you will have least competitors in the space. So you will have a lot of time to explore a lot of things again. So every time when it comes to a business person, when it comes to an entrepreneur, when it comes to a businessman, the highest of time he'll be concentrating is on his competitors. Like he'll be thinking of how what the competitor is doing, what is the price of the commodity that is sold at the competitors. So I can bring out something better in order to compete with him. So it's like that time which you spend on the competitor can be spent on further innovating the processes that is involved. And you can actually swim through the blue ocean at ease. So that's all about being an entrepreneur and a businessman. Now you can decide on being a businessman or an entrepreneur, or you can start off by being a businessman and move towards being an entrepreneur. Now I'll just give you an example of the blue ocean and the red ocean strategy. Most of you might not know this example. Cirque du Soleil, this particular modern circus is based out of Canada, while the Barnum and Bailey, it was America's famous traditional circus. So if you see the difference in these two things, Cirque du Soleil, they actually swam through the blue ocean strategy, while Barnum and Bailey, they had to swim through the red ocean strategy. It's because they followed the traditional methods of doing it, and it turned out to be very expensive. Maintaining the animals are very much expensive. Moving it from one place to the other is again expensive. And like when it comes to maintaining animals, you need people exclusively for maintaining animals. It's not just going to be the people who are part of the circus event. It's going to be more resource that will be investing on them. So in that case, Barnum and Bailey ended up as you know, most traditional circuses have failed in the recent market trend, because they could hardly spend any money on that, as the number of audience decreased over a period of time. But when it came to Cirque du Soleil, the main advantage they had was they replaced all the animals with human beings. Like this particular circus, the modern circus, they replaced animals. And when it comes to Barnum and Bailey, they'll be having hundreds and hundreds of people who will be involved in the process. But when it comes to Cirque du Soleil, the highest they'll have in a team is only 30 people. And the same 30 people will involve in the whole process. So the thing is that they could pay all the 30 people better, and they could actually come out with better ideas of later on. Like they started off innovating by the end of 90s, while Barnum and Bailey was becoming extinct towards the 21st century. Cirque du Soleil, they entered the technological space as well. Recent days they have AR and VR incorporated into their circus events, and this way it was totally new, and they had loads and loads of audiences coming in, and they had videos posted on different technological platforms, and they made money out of that as well. So this is the edge which I am talking about. The process is same, the business is same, just that they have innovated in terms of replacement of a resource, substituting a resource, and enhancing the process, improvising the process with lesser resource that is available. In case of Barnum and Bailey, they had to work with 100 people, but when it came to Cirque du Soleil, they only had some 30 people, but they were able to pull off with just the 30 people, and they were able to be successful as well. So this is the edge which will bring out a difference between Blue Ocean and Red Ocean strategy. In this case, Barnum and Bailey, the founders of the particular traditional circus, they are business people, to give you an idea. And Cirque du Soleil, the founder, Solil is the founder. Solil, he is an entrepreneur. So let's get into the core topic, entrepreneurial traits. I hope I give you a clearer picture about entrepreneurship, entrepreneur, business, industrialist, and blue ocean and red ocean strategy. I'll be more happier if you have more of doubts from whatever I'm going through, like the whole set of slides. Like, I want you to just comment your doubts straight on. I'll just respond back to your comments at the end of the session. So what is a trait? Most of you might think you might not know what trait is all about, or you might know what trait is all about, but trait is something that makes up an individual's personality. Your personality is made of your traits. Most traits you might already know. Your trait can be you might be an introvert, or you might be an extrovert, or you might be confident enough, or you actually might be a very expressive person, or you might actually be very much persuasive in your talks. So all these will contain the traits. And one other thing is that we usually have this doubt whether trait is going to be genetic, hereditary, or it is going to be environmental causes that will. Commenting on this, we can again going on, it is going to be your nature, or you're going to nurture a trait. So this is going, and more, I'm discussing this because very often people think that whenever someone is trying out something, they'll be like, it's their inborn characteristic, so they are able to pull it off very well. There is nothing like that. Actually, every individual, they'll be having their own sets of strengths. They'll be having their own sets of weaknesses. It's only about setting yourself in an environment and nurturing the particular trait which interests you best. Like, you can explore the possibilities of your interest, your priority, knowing yourself, and eventually you can nurture a particular trait. And nothing is going to be just genetic. So that way, it's not only if people are talented inborn, or I am totally against this particular statement. Talented inborn is not happening. Every time, talent is acquired over a period of time, and some people, they acquire the talent, they explore their talent. It's more like exploring the talent. They'll actually have it within, but it will be underexplored. So exploring a talent or exploring a trait, it will happen over a period of time through the processes which you undergo. So it's it's not genetic. It's not purely genetic. It's not purely environmental. It's both genetic and both environmental. You have something within, you will be exploring the same, you will be understanding things better, and you will be able to nurture a trait. So that's about traits. So these five basic traits will make up an individual. Just the priority of things might vary from one person to the other. As in, the level of trait priorities might vary from one person to the other. Number one is agreeableness. So trust, altruism, kindness, affection, almost all the pro-social behaviors, like how you are towards another individual, how you deal with another individual. You and someone, you and a group of people, when it comes to something like that, it will include your opinions. It will include your trust towards someone. It will include your opinion towards someone, and your view towards things. All this will come in, views towards individuals will come in this. So that's agreeableness. Next is conscientiousness. So this is totally about thoughts. It's just going to be you. Like, you and yourself alone. A person is highly conscientious when he's going to be high level, when he is going to have high level of thoughts. He'll be thinking about a lot of things, all you might have come across people who keeps thinking, or who might have thoughts on everything, who might have an opinion on everything, and they'll be able to control their impulse best, and they'll be very much directed and oriented. Now the next in line is extroversion. So it's about sociability, like how you project yourself. The first one, agreeableness, is how you accept someone. When it comes to extroversion, it's about projecting yourself, how you will be accepted by someone, or how you are going to project yourself to the society. So sociability, talkativeness, assertiveness, and excitability, all this will fall within extroversion. Next in line is neuroticism. So this is all about your lows, like depression, sadness, moodiness, emotional instability, like all this is going to be about your negative vibes of your personality. Next in line is openness. So openness, it's all about being creative, happy about thinking about concepts, about abstract concepts. So every time when it comes to traits, these five main traits makes up an individual, and it's like more often it's only about yourself. At times it will include yourself and a group of people, or yourself and things, or yourself and the environment in which you are. So all this will make up your personality. Now let's get into detail about the case specific entrepreneurial traits. Right. Now when it comes to the entrepreneurial traits which I'm going to discuss today, I'll be discussing on what the particular trait means and why is it important. So to start off, self-aware, according to me, like I've prioritized the whole list according to myself. You can rearrange the order, you might be taking notes, you can rearrange the order. I want you to just ponder over things in order to prioritize the trait which I'm going to list down now. So self-awareness, by the word, you'll actually know what it actually means. Knowing yourself, I think I bored you with the same head the other day during the presentation. It's about knowing yourself. You should be very clear about yourself. So initially you have to spend time for yourself in order to know yourself. And the knowledge about yourself is very much important, because only then you will be able to know your uniqueness, and you will be knowing your strengths, you will be knowing your weaknesses. Again, when it comes to strengths and weaknesses, your opinions might vary from one to the other. Right. So why is it important? I have discussed it already. Self-awareness. You have to spend time for yourself in order to get eventually there. How will it happen? You have to spend time every day, number one. And number two is, you should be able to question yourself on what is happening and what you are up to. These are the two questions that will bring out clarity about yourself. Like, what is happening around you that is because of you, and what you are doing towards it. This is all the process about. By this, you will actually, and initially, like I've told you, like you'll, why is it important? Because you have to understand your uniqueness, your strengths and weaknesses. You might think like at once, just you can think now and you will be like, okay, this might be my uniqueness and this might be my strengths, or this might be my weakness. You might take it that way, but the fact is that all this happens progressively, all this happens incrementally. I'll give you my example. For instance, 10 years back, my opinions on things were different. Like I actually, I didn't pursue to be an entrepreneur in the tech space, as in not exactly in the information tech space, but my interest was automobile. Secondly, my interest was physics. So I wanted to do something with particular regards to physics and automobile. But later on with time, and more specific, I was more into aerodynamics. My basic interest was aerodynamics. But with time, what I could make out was, if I'm going to just be focused at that, I'll not be open to problems. So being an entrepreneur, that happened over a period of 10 years. So plotting your uniqueness or becoming completely self-aware is not going to happen within a minute or within 10 minutes of time. It's going to be progressive, but it's very essential to spend time for yourself, to be very much self-aware. And your priorities, you might ask, like, if it is going to be progressive, then why is it necessary to know myself? It is like, I might know myself already. There might be something in you which you will not be knowing now, or there might be something in you which was actually underexplored. So it is very much essential to explore yourself in order to plot out the uniqueness and also your strengths and weaknesses. And this should be done almost every day or at least once in a week. But periodically it should be done in order to grow yourself in all possible dimensions, like emotionally, professionally, personally. By all means and ways, you have to, you should be in a position to grow yourself. So self-awareness, the primary trait, according to my priority. You can have it on the list, prioritize it later. All right. Decisions. So this actually, I'm having it on second of the list, making decisions. So making a decision is a higher priority. Like, this involves a lot of trait, but making decision itself is a trait. But decision making is not just going to happen with your thoughts alone. It will involve a lot of factors. It will involve the factors like resources available, the people you have with you, the idea which you might want to start off with. All this will play a vital role. But for making a decision, this particular trait of making decision will eventually get you there, where you can consider all that is available. You will be able to be in a position to analyze all what is available and eventually get there to decide something. So for instance, consider you are planning to you are coming up with an idea of cultivating tea. So before you take the decision, you will consider, like, will I be able to do it? So in order to answer it, you have to consider factors like the resource that is available. Like, do you have the financial resource? Do you have the human resource? Do you have the technological resource? Is it legal? So all these factors have to be considered before you get there. So thoughtfulness and self-awareness plays a vital role in making decision. And once you're done with all these priorities, like prioritizing things, you can eventually get there to make your own decisions to pull things off. So it's like multiple traits involved, and this stands alone because of its specificity of ending up with something, concluding on something. So decision making is all about concluding on something with what you have. This is a very essential trait of an entrepreneur, because if a decision is not made, a thought or an idea will still remain an idea. So this plays a crucial role in getting into something. Although self-awareness is essential, decision making is crucial in getting into something. You might think, like, does decision making happen over and over? It's like a day-to-day process. For instance, even your food choices, you might think of having pizza this day, but deciding on pizza, you might be considering a lot of factors. Like, you might be thinking that I had burger yesterday, I had sandwich for the breakfast, so pizza will be a good deal. Even when it comes to pizza, you are coming out with choices. Similarly, when it's going to be entrepreneurship, you will have the whole range of resources, factors that is to be considered all in front of you. So before deciding, you will be considering all of it, prioritizing things and concluding things. Right. It actually involves six phases. I actually gave you a brief picture about decision making, but it includes six major processes. One is you might end up identifying a problem. It's like you might identify a problem in which they are spending much on spraying pesticides for cultivating. So you might find that as a problem, and you might find all possible things that will support your particular problem which you're talking about. Like, it could be like the amount of pesticide that is being sprayed, the cost involved in spraying that, the effectiveness of the pesticide, the efficiency of the pesticide, like how efficient it is, and how much does it give out on yield. So all these data should be gathered up in order to support your problem. Then you have to relate the ideas and analyze it. Like, you have to come out with some sort of comparisons and correlations between idea. Like, you might come out with a better pesticide idea at the end of it, but you have to compare different processes involved in the particular system in order to come out with the particular idea to solve the problem. So analyzing the data is very much essential. Next in line, you will be focusing on plotting alternative solutions. Like, you might come out with an idea of a whole new pesticide, or you might come out with an idea of new idea of spraying the pesticide, or increasing the yield using the same pesticide. And you will be having a list of solutions for the very problem which you're plotting out. And you will be prioritizing the best solution out of it. And when you are coming out with the best solution, you will be piloting the solution. Like, you will be trying out it in a small scale. Like, you will be trying it out or piloting it out in a small area of land. You will be using the pesticide, and you will observe the results, document the results, and you will be in a position to give a better picture and have a better picture about the process that is going to be enhanced. And eventually you can decide on taking that as a path in solving the particular problem. So before I take you further, it's like, you have to identify a problem, gather data about the problem, compare and correlate the data, formulate alternative solutions for the very problem, and you have to plot the best solution out of the list of solutions which you already have, and you have to pilot the solution, and finally decide or plan on going ahead with the further processes of solving the problem with the particular solution. Right. For all this, you need self-confidence. Like, for making a decision, or even knowing yourself, it actually takes much of your confidence. Because very often what happens is that, it goes hand in hand. Like, being self-aware will enhance your self-confidence, and being self-confident will enable you to explore yourself more. So I'll just give you a picture of how it works. It's like, when it comes to becoming self-aware, I'll actually think of all that I already have. So that in itself will enhance your self-confidence. For instance, I might think I'll only be able to talk in front of 10 people, but my potential of doing that could be talking in front of 100 people. So that will eventually turn out to be when you're going to explore yourself, and it will enhance your self-confidence. So here, when it comes to faith in their self-confidence, is nothing about faith in your own abilities. Like, you should, for having faith in your own abilities, convincing yourself with your abilities, you have to know yourself first, explore your abilities, explore the whole range of possibilities, whole range of things that could be done with your abilities, and all this will enhance your self-confidence. And this is very much essential in doing business or pursuing entrepreneurship. Because take the case of yourself and your family. Consider you are having a thought of trying out a business. So in order to try out a business, you should initially be convinced with a particular idea, right? So in order to convince yourself with a particular idea, you have to have the confidence in you. You have to really think about of pulling it off, and you will be thinking of all the possible abilities which you have, which will enhance the process of pulling the particular startup off or pursuing entrepreneurship. Only then you will be able to convince the people whom you want to work for you or whom you think should admonish your decisions. For instance, in case of families, like when it came to me, I had to convince myself first, and then I had to go on to convince my parents with a particular idea of pursuing entrepreneurship. So before that, I was making myself sure that I'm confident enough with a particular idea and on myself to be able to convince my parents. So it's like when it comes to something of something like entrepreneurship, it will involve much of yourself, and you will have to position yourself in a forum, in a group of people, or it might be a system. So you should be self-confident enough to pull things off. So self-confidence is one other trait that plays a vital role, and this will enhance your day-to-day's process as well. Right. Like I said in the beginning, entrepreneurship is all about risk-taking. Risk-taking is not a trait, but reasonable risk-taking is a trait. You might think, like, what is the difference between reasonable risk-taking and risk-taking? So, risk-taking is like, for instance, consider you are in a falls, waterfalls, and you are on top of something, like, on top of a hill, and right down like 10 feet, some 30 feet down, you can dive in into a pool or something. So for this, you will not actually be calculative, because consider you have not been there already. You hardly know what is happening there. But the only thing you wish to do is take the risk of just diving into the pool. Here, there is no reasonable risk taking. It's because you haven't given much of thought. You just planned on jumping and you did it. But when it comes to reasonable risk taking, you'll actually approximate the depth of the pool. You'll actually approximate the height of the dive which you're going to be in the air. And you'll actually be thinking about your abilities to swim through. You'll actually think about the possible results of jumping into the particular pool. So reasonable risk taking is all about giving thoughts before taking a plunge. So this is actually a crucial, this is again crucial when it comes to an entrepreneur. Let me tell you why. So when it comes to, more often, when you start pursuing entrepreneurship, this will not make much of a difference. Like, you will be pursuing entrepreneurship all alone. And later on, when you have more and more of people working for you, you will have all their responsibilities on top of you. More often the entrepreneurs are very much stressed for this very reason, because they are forced to consider the people's lives that is involved in the whole process of pursuing their vision. And in order to take a plunge, they have to be very clear about the possible consequences, about the possible, they should be protective enough to consider all these factors of, they should be able to take momentary and spontaneous decisions in order to have much impact on their people. For instance, take the case of Corona itself. It's like, consider an established company. They are having 100 people in hand. They can't, of course, Corona would have hampered their revenue, but just like that, they can't decide on firing people off. Just like that, they can't decide on giving pay cuts to the employees. Just like that, they can't reduce the resource, that is, reduce the perks that are available to the employees. Before they could do all this, they have to think about all the possible consequences. For instance, firing people off just like that might hamper their reputation in the market. No other people will again be interested in choosing their company over the other companies, because they'll have a picture like this company is not having much of a secured job setup and will not have the freedom of working there. Our pay might get cut at some point of time. We don't have much of perks that might get at any point of time. So eventually, for taking some risks of that kind, they'll be giving it a lot of thoughts. They'll be considering all the possible factors, and they'll be plunging in. So reasonable risk taking is a crucial trait, vital trait, but not as crucial as the previous decision making trait. Next in line is self-motivation. Most of you might know what self-motivation actually means. Like, you have to pump up your own self. Like, you have to have clarity about the happenings in your lives, and you should be able to push yourself towards something. Like, self-push is very much essential. Because if you don't do that, you'll sit. Like, why is self-motivation very much important? Self-motivation is nothing but achieving something because of one's own enthusiasm or interest. Why is it important? When it comes to entrepreneurship, it's just going to be yourself. There will not be much of people to push you towards something, because the idea is all your own. You are the one who is going to explore the particular idea. You are the one who knows what the idea is all about and what the processes that has evolved over a period of time. And you are the only one who is going to know the consequences of the processes that is going to happen. At least, even if you don't know, but you might actually predict to an extent of the happenings that is ahead of you. Calculative risk, like I told you already. So in that case, motivation from an external push is not possible, because it might be irrelevant to you. More often, it might be irrelevant to you, or they'll not be able to pursue your whole set of thoughts. So it's like, when it comes to entrepreneurship, it's better to be your own, better to be on your own than to be influenced by something, because every time you will be looking for some other push to get towards your own interest. When you are wishing to be self-motivated, all you have to think of is why you really got ahead with a particular idea. For instance, if you are starting off with a particular idea, you are almost towards coming out with a product out of the particular idea. More often, what will happen is that, in my case, I'll just give you my example. You might already know, like, I dropped off my chances of leaving to Oxford or Harvard, and I pursued entrepreneurship. So I thought finding a tech partner is pretty much easy. But it was not that easy, and eventually we could find someone. Like, it took me close to 6 months to find a like-minded tech entrepreneur who will co-find our business. But after over a period of 2 years of work, he decided that he is not going to work on it anymore. So it's like the process of these 2 years only I'll be aware of. If I ever thought that, okay, it's done, I'm the co-founder who is technical has lost interest on my product, I'm not going to get anything further. Like, I'm not going to get ahead in this process because I don't have anything. All my efforts that went into it for 2 years has gone in vain. If I ever took it that way, I wouldn't have moved. But the only thing that pushed me further was the main purpose of starting my whole idea. My purpose was towards enhancing the standards of people's lives. So it's not like I was totally dependent on the idea. I was having my whole range of trusts and believes in my idea and not on people. So when I had all my trust and all my interest into my ideas, and whenever I think of why I started, that itself gave me a exponential push. Like, I never thought I'll be starting off straight away. Like, he told me on a Monday morning, he responded to me telling that, sorry, Tony, I'm not going to work with you any longer. I have different priorities to work on. I'm not able to give time for this particular vision of yours. And I was like, it was just a text. He didn't even call me. He texted me saying all this. And it took me close to 6 hours to get out of it. But that very evening, I started off finding another technical partner who can pull things off from wherever he paused. So eventually, I found a partner. The process resumed within a week's time. Like, I found him. I explained things to him. He was interested. But this doesn't mean that this co-founder of mine is not going to leave anytime. He might leave anytime, but I came into this only for the sake of my interest and the idea which I started off. It's just going to be me and my idea. So when it comes to me and my idea, I only have to move towards my idea, and I'll be least dependent on all the resources that is available to me. Because at the end of the day, you have so much resources in front of you. So all you have to do is just explore and move further. That's it. So why is it important? It'll enable you to keep going even when there are setbacks, like the example I gave you. And you might not know, you might have better opportunities right in front of you. The co-founder the resource which you find will actually be better than the previous resource. The commitment they show towards the product might be better than the previous resource which you had already. So self-motivation will enable you to keep going. That's all about self-motivation. And this decision-making is essential for you to get started. Self-confidence is essential for you to keep yourself going day by day. Self-motivation is essential for you to enhance yourself when there are going to be setbacks. Right. Next in line, we have empathy. Most of you might be aware of sympathy, but not many people are aware of empathy. And it's a crucial mistake most entrepreneurs do. They hardly be in other people's shoes to understand what is happening. Empathy is very much important, because when you're going to pursue entrepreneurship, it's not going to be just you. There are three kinds of people involved. One, you and your company, that is your team. Number two, the customers who are going to who are going to be your customers, who will benefit out of your idea, and number three, who are going to be your potential customers. The potential customers who will eventually be your customers. So empathy is very much essential in these three cases. I'll just tell you how. Number one, when it comes to your company, consider yours as an agri-tech company, and the process you are involved in is cultivating tea. You should actually be able to understand the feelings of the person who is cropping tea, and only when you are able to understand their feelings, you will be in a position to listen to them. So listening to them is very much important, because you are only watching over what is happening. Only they are the people who are very much involved in the process. So understanding others' feelings, that is, in case of your company, you should understand the feelings of your team in order to understand the whole process that is going on. And this will actually enhance the process. More often, the employees and the team members, they'll be like, okay, my opinion is, I have voiced out my opinion, and there is someone who is listening to me, my leader or my boss is actually listening to me. Be it you consider the opinion or not, but you have listened to it and you have responded back to it. So that is actually going to enhance the whole process, improvise the process, number one. Number two, he might have done something better. So you have to be in a position to appreciate the particular employee. And when it comes to customers, number one, you have to understand your products from the customer's perspective. Empathy in that angle is very much important. So it's like when you have a product, you might actually, when it comes to your own product, you will be very much obsessed with the product. It's very bad to be obsessed with the product. You should actually be like a common spectator when it comes to understanding the customer. You should be a common spectator in order to understand the real look and feel of your product. For instance, consider you're selling tea. You have to compare it with the other tea in the market, and you should be able to understand how your tea is better than the competitive product or how your tea is worse than the competitive product. Only if you are able to understand it that way, only if you are able to listen to customers that way, you will be in a position to leverage the process, leverage the quality of your product, leverage the weak points that the customers have plotted. So that is very much essential. You might be aware of the reviews and ratings that are available on most e-commerce sites, like even in Amazon, like whatever e-commerce sites you take for that instance. They are very much keen about, and more and more of AI tech is being worked on analyzing the reviews, the real feel of reviews, and that is being done just to understand the real feel of the product in the customer's market, in order to enhance the product, in order to enhance the process involved in making the product, and enhance the company as a whole. So empathy in that angle is important. And number three, empathy towards your potential customers. So you can actually convince them only if you are in their position. Like, take for instance, you are coming out with a product, you wish to sell it to me. You are the entrepreneur. Your product is tea, a peculiar form of tea maybe, and you wish to sell it to me. You have to understand my feelings, like my priority towards tea, and my interest in the kind of tea, and how dependent I am on tea. All this should be understood in order to penetrate your idea into myself, or at least give me an understanding of your product. So it's like empathy is very much important in these three classes of people that is involved in entrepreneurship. So why is it important? You have to appreciate, you have to manipulate, and you have to enhance the productivity. So that's all about empathy. So being empathetic is also crucial when it comes to a entrepreneurial journey. Right. So only when you are able to be, only when you are empathetic, you will be able to be persuasive. Like being persuasive, again, it goes in three processes. One, your customers. Two, your potential customers. Three, your team members. So being persuasive with empathy is very much essential. Right. Versatile. You might know this already. Being versatile is, again, it's very much essential when it comes to an entrepreneur, because an entrepreneur starts a journey all on his own, alone, just him. There will be no one else to accompany you. In some cases, you might have your friend with you, but it's just going to be you and your friend. So being versatile is very much essential. So what is being versatile? When it comes to a company like cultivating tea, or maybe you're bored with the example of tea, I'll take another example. Consider you're having a software company. There will be different processes involved in a software company, although you will not be aware of it before you start it. But with time, you will be able to, like, you have to file your taxes, you have to keep you have to document the accounts, and you have to build softwares, you have to sell software, and you have to plan the way ahead for the software. But it will only be you or two of you. So in this case, you have to have multifaceted, multitasking. You should be able to multitask, and you should be able to be versatile, and you should be able to perform different functions. Only that will get you going, because it's like initially you'll not be having much of resources in order to pull on with your startup. If you're going to invest on all the functions, that is, like if you're going to have a resource for accounting, have a resource for documenting the same, and if you're going to have a software developer with the least resource you have, that is close to impossible to my knowledge. So in order to pull this off, at least for a year or two with your startup, you should be multifaceted. So I'll give you my example. Mine is a startup. I am the business founder of the startup, and we have a technical founder, technical co-founder. He'll be completely involved in production that involves back-end, front-end integration. So we usually, in case of companies, there will be a separate team for back-end, separate team for front-end, and separate team for integration. But when it comes to a startup, only the individual will be involving in all the three processes. So when it comes to me, I have to strategize, I have to establish partnerships, I have to involve in business development, that is marketing and sales, I have to involve in filing of taxes, I have to take care of the accounts. So in this case, being versatile is very much essential. Only that will save on your resource, number one, and you will be able to pull on with whatever resource you have, number two. And number three is that only if you're going to be versatile, while your company grows, you might have separate teams for each process. You will actually have a clearer picture of your company. Like being versatile will enable you to have a clearer picture of your whole system. Like consider you have a person for marketing, and he is not doing any kind of work. He is just skipping things off, and he is bluffing to you, saying that you will be in a position to predict, or you will be in a position to understand that he is fooling you around only if you have involved in marketing and sales. So when your company evolves, being versatile will enable you to understand your system best. It will not only save on your resources, it will not only leverage your it will not only enable you to improvise with the resources you have, it will also enable you to know your system best. So being versatile is important for three reasons. You will be knowing the process, and you will be able to manage the process better, the various roles, and you will be knowing your system best, and you will be able to save on resources, including time and money. So that's all about the trait versatility, and this versatility will play a vital role when you have already started the process. Like you have made a decision, you have confidently convinced your parents, and you're pulling off the particular idea, and you're starting to work off. So that's when versatility will play a crucial role. Right. Being creative, I had it in the lower order, because more often entrepreneurs, they get drowned in the thoughts of creativity. Like and also there is a misconception that only if someone is creative, they have to start off with the process of entrepreneurship. Like they should be pursuing the particular process. It doesn't work that way. It's like you should be actually be creative enough to come out with an idea for plot. Like you will initially plot a problem, and you have to be creative enough in coming out with a solution that will be your idea. Although you do all this, creativity is lower in order, because being too much creative is going to hamper your whole process. Like you'll consider you're drowning yourself in thoughts, you will actually be not involved in much of the processes that is happening day to day. This actually did happen to me because I actually spent a lot of time on thinking over things. And what really happened is that our product could have reached the market much earlier than it is taking now. Like, our product is yet to reach the market. So creativity and thoughts towards creativity has hampered the process, and we are taking a longer time to eventually get there. So being creative is essential, but drowning yourself into creativity is bad. So there are two ways of being creative. One is they either do new things or they do things differently. So again, it goes back to the initial statement which I coined, saying that you will actually be coming out with an idea that might become a sector on its own, or you might be innovating within the sector. You might be coming out with better processes within the sector. Like in automobile sector, you might come out with some processes that is going to enhance the electric cars that is in the lineup for the next few years. So creativity can happen in two ways. One is you might come out with something completely new that will result in a sector, or you might be improvising the existing processes. So that's about doing things differently. Right. Next in line is disciplined. So it's very much essential to be disciplined when it comes to pursuing entrepreneurship. The thing is that we'll be having we should be in a position to develop the product. We should also spend time on reading. We should spend time on ourselves. We should spend time with the family. So all this is possible only if you're going to time frame it. So discipline, the basic discipline starts within you only when you're going to time frame things. So once when you systemize things, once when you organize things, once you have set time for everything, then you can go on to systemize the particular process. You can organize on how you're going to spend your time with your family. Initially, it will be like, I'll be spending half an hour with your family. That will be the entry point. I'll be spending 2 hours on developing a product. I'll be spending 2 hours on reading a content, or this is how it will start. But with time, you have to progressively become disciplined over and over again. And discipline is again progressive. It's like you will be becoming more and more disciplined. So the thing is that once when you have set time for everything, you will be experimenting, and you will be trying out new things and setting new standards for your process within. Like within the 2 hours of time, you initially will plan on developing a product for 2 hours. Then next in line, what you will do is you will try to become more efficient in utilizing those 2 hours. Like for instance, consider you are having a 30-minute window of four processes that will involve in development. You'll actually be having, you'll be trying to do that in 15 minutes, and you'll be accelerating the whole process. And the thing is that when it takes 10 days, it might take 10 days to complete a work, but when it is going to be disciplined, you might end up doing the work in just 5 days or even shorter time. So it is very, very much essential to be disciplined, number one. So all this while I was talking about yourself alone when it comes to discipline. So next, the discipline will play a vital role when it comes to forming a team, because it's not necessary that all your team members will have the same level of discipline as you, or they might not work in the same way you work. But you can actually set your company standards, you can set your company system, you can actually establish standards for your system with your own discipline. Like, you will be having a set of discipline for the company. You'll be having a set of principles and policies for the company. All this will evolve from the basic discipline which you set for yourself. So, number one, why is it important to have work discipline? Number one is stability and structure into your personal life. And next is pass it on. Like you will be, it will just get pushed on to the others in your team. And they might find it better to work that way. And your whole system will get structured. And eventually that might become your culture. Your office culture might evolve from your discipline. So discipline plays a, again, plays a crucial role in the entrepreneurial journey. So inquisitive. Inquisitive is nothing but exploring, like learning new things. It's about exploring the underexplored, exploring yourself, exploring the world, exploring ideas, exploring technology. It can be anything. So being inquisitive is very much essential. But when it comes to the particular regards, and one more thing is that learning new things by all ways and means, because whenever you try to learn something new, it might not support your processes now, it might not enhance your life now, but eventually this learning of yours will support your life better. Or like you might not know that your life has gotten better because of the learning which you did previously. So I'll just give you one of my examples. So initially, my only interest was to explore India. I visited a lot of places in India. I went to close to 15 states in India. And the main purpose of visiting is that I wanted to understand the culture. I wanted to explore the places. I wanted to go trekking, hiking, explore things around there, try the foods there. But what eventually happened is that only these 2 years during which I traveled enabled me to come out with an idea. Like during my travel, I could, this is going to be a common story with many entrepreneurs. Like even if you take the case of Uber's founder, Travis Kalanick, he was traveling from Canada to UK. So what he found was the cabs in UK are very much expensive. So, but the main focus, as in his focus towards reaching out to UK, was he was interested in understanding cloud kitchen. But he could find this problem of higher priority. So, like it eventually, and he eventually ended up finding Uber. Similarly, when it came to me, my main focus was to explore places with regards to its food habits, culture, and things. But in addition to that, I could understand the market, that is like the nature of the market that prevailed in the particular states and cities. So from the learnings which happened, it was not like I learned it. The learnings happened to me. I experienced things and I brainstormed on things in order to come out with an idea. So it's essential to be inquisitive in order to understand things better, which might get you somewhere which will eventually enhance your life way better than you actually think. So being inquisitive is essential. Again, independent. It's like very often becoming independent, completely self-reliant, doesn't happen overnight. It's like till my age of till I was in class 8, I can hardly travel alone. Like I'll either be taken by my parents somewhere, even when it comes to from my place to another, my hometown, it's hardly like 120 kilometers, but I can hardly travel it alone. So what happened is that it actually, I didn't have much of self-confidence. All this resulted from a lack of self-confidence. And I'll not be in a position to explore a lot of things because I don't have confidence on myself and I'm dependent on people. So I should be, I will only be in a position to take their directions. I'll only be in a position to listen what they think about the particular process. Even when it comes to traveling from here to there, they'll instruct me to get a ticket. They'll instruct me to pay for the ticket. And I'll be watching them on how to sit in the bus. All this is not going to be independent. So when it came, like when I was in class, I started going on trips. Again, I was dependent. It's like I started going on trips with my friends. That to a level is some level of self-reliance, but it's not completely independent on doing things. But over a period of time, whenever I was... all this happened when I went through the process. So going through a process will make you more and more independent. Exploring new things on your own and experimenting process and making yourself a part of the process will make you independent. So eventually, when I finished my school, I started going on loan trips. Like, I'll never know the place. All I'll have in hand is the information about the place which I explore, which I serve the previous night on Google. I'll just have information about the place, about the food there, about the conveyance there, how to commute from the railway station or from the airport to the other places around there, and the famous foods there, the kind of people there, the language they speak. All the information I'll have in hand from the from Google the previous night I served. So with all that information, I started exploring places, and that confidence which I acquired over a period of time by experimenting myself through the processes have made me independent. So this particular trait of yours, like becoming self-reliant, becoming independent, will actually fall in place when you are ready to explore yourself, experiment yourself into a process, when you are going to involve yourself in the process, and only when you are going to try out new processes. So becoming independent is essential, and this essential trait will reach out to you only when you are going to involve yourself in the processes. All right. Resourcefulness. So again, it has something to do with the this trait of yours, being inquisitive. So being inquisitive will enable you to have a number of ideas. So whenever there is a situation, you will actually be in a position to explore things on your own. Only if you are able to explore things on your own, you will be able to come out of it on your own. And pursuing entrepreneurship, it's totally about you and yourself alone. So it's very much essential to be resourceful. You should always, rather than making complaints, like rather than making excuses or complaining that this is not happening, I don't have enough information, or else like I don't have enough resource, or I don't know this, or this I can't work on. Instead of making excuses, you should actually be able to try out it, plot the ways of doing it. You should actually be in a position to explore things on your own. And over a period of time, you might actually become quick in doing things that way. That's about, like, initially you will be inquisitive. You will be exploring new things. And over a period of time, you might have you might have enhanced your process with discipline. And over a period of time, you would have ended up with shortcuts that would enable you to get things done even more quicker, and eventually you will become resourceful. So being resourceful will involve being disciplined, being inquisitive, and being self-confident. So almost all the traits are dependent on one or the other. So why is it important to being resourceful? Only this will enable you to get things done over doing things. It's like, consider you're asked to pump water out of a well. So it's like, you might actually try. You might end up with nothing, no water, because you have not really explored whether pumping, just a hand pump will enable you to get the water out of it. You should actually be in a position to explore all the possible ways to get water out of it and not just use the hand pump. So making excuses, that's the difference. Like being resourceful and making excuses is just that. Like you should be in a position to find the possible way, the best possible way to get something done over just doing, like trying the traditional ways of doing it and ending up, you are trying something new. So you have to be resourceful to try out new things rather than trying the same old traditional ways on doing the new things. So making excuses is not good for an entrepreneur. Being resourceful is essential for an entrepreneur. All right. Resilient. So when it comes to an entrepreneur, difficult conditions and difficult times are common in an entrepreneur's life. It will actually become their day-to-day life. They'll be forced to experience all possible difficult conditions. So you have to become create a personality in which you should be able to withstand the particular difficult condition, and you should be only if you're able to withstand it, you will be able to recover from it. You will be able to come out of it, or you will be used to it at some point of time. Like for instance, if there is a difficult condition and if it is going to persist for a while, you have to get used to it, and you have to be in a position to improvise with what you have in that difficult condition to reach your vision. So it's like you have to endure it, you have to understand it, and so for enduring it, again, you need empathy and self-confidence, and you have to understand it. While you are able to understand it, you will be able to create resilience to the particular situation. So once you are done with understanding the problem, you will be able to create resistance to the problem, and you will be able to endure the problem. And eventually that will actually become a part of your life. So that condition will no longer be difficult for you. So why is it important? It will enable you to protect yourself, and it will enable, number two, it's not just going to be you. You includes your company, your team, the people who are dependent on you, not only your team, the customers. So being resilient and understanding difficult conditions is very much essential. And only then you can remain stable. It's like when you're not resilient, you will be yielding yourself to highs and lows. Like you will be depressed, or you will be having you will not be able to pull things off. You will not remain self-motivated as ever. So remaining stable is possible only by being resilient to conditions. So resilience is an essential trait. Right. So being goal-oriented. 1 second. Right. Being goal-oriented, you will actually set a long-term goal that will actually be, for instance, in case of tea, your long-term goal is to create the highest quality of tea, to create the best of brands, the best reputed brand in the world of tea. In order to reach out to the long-term goal, you will be having a lot of short-term goals. Like the initial process would be to understand the tea cultivation process, and next in line you will be innovating the process, and next in line you will be coming out with solutions to solve specific problems within the process. And all this, initially you will be setting a long-term goal, and then it will start off with your short-term goal. Once you are setting up a short-term goal, next in line is actually process oriented. I'll just give you an idea about both. It's essential to be both process oriented and also goal oriented. It's like I explained the T process. It's like your primary goal, the long term goal, is to set the most reputed T brand in the world. Your short term goal would be to find all the possible T brands in the market. So like you will be exploring things, and the process involved in this is you will be surfing online, you will be doing some ground studies, you will be going through research papers to find all the possible details about the brands in the market. And in order to understand the process involved in making of tea, you might explore a lot of things. So at every point of time when you are involved in the process, you should ensure that all the process involved in the whole setup or environment which you have created is oriented towards the long-term goal which you have set, and also oriented towards the short-term goal which you have set. The short-term goal is only about finding the tea brands in the world. So what happens is that when you're just goal-oriented, what you'll do is you'll not involve yourself in the process. So you will leave out on topics. For instance, when it comes to finding out, the short-term goal is to find the best tea brands in the world. What you will do is you will just read one or two, you will be thinking about your short-term goal of finding the best brands, and you will lose out yourself on reading out a lot of things. Like you will just be limited to Googling, surfing things on Google alone. You will actually not reading any research paper. You will actually not see a time scale of the evolution of brands over a period of time and how it has evolved. So you will be going into detail only if you are process oriented. When you are just goal oriented, you will lose out on the process. You will not be able to understand the process. You will not be able to understand things better that will enable you to reach out to the goal. So it's essential to be goal oriented instantaneously, momentarily. For instance, once in a day, you should revisit your short-term goal, but it's very essential to immerse yourself in the process that is happening, that is working you towards the short-term goal which you have set. And one other risk is that whenever you are orienting yourself towards the process, you will be too much immersed in the process and you will lose out on the short-term goal which you have set. That is again not good because all this works on time, and time is money. So all you have to do is you have to interlink the short-term goal and the process involved in the short-term goal, and overlay all this onto time. Like you have to set a time frame for the process, and you have to have a clear idea about the goal which you would end up with, the results of the particular process. And goal orientation and process orientation goes hands in hand, and you have to create a balance between goal orientation and process orientation by the time frame you set. So you should have that clarity. So why is it important? It's important that way because only that will enable you to incrementally move towards your goal. If you're going to become very much process oriented, you'll forget your long-term goal, and you'll be spending a lot of time in a short-term goal. That is again bad. You have to, for incrementally moving towards your goal, it's essential to orient your process and also your short-term goals and eventually your long-term goals, overlay all this onto time. And one other advantage of doing this is you can improvise best. Like you can improvise the process which is involved in knowing or understanding the short-term goal which you have set, which will enhance the long-term goal. So process orientation and goal orientation goes hand in hand, and it is essential to give equal priority to both considering the time frame. So persistent, again, it's like you have to endure all the process and you have to be focused at what you're moving at, and doing it every day is essential towards reaching out to your goal. So persistence is a primary trait. Collaboration, again, when you start off, like consider you are a team of two, you and your friend who are going to co-find your business. You have to understand each other. You have to understand your strengths and weaknesses, and you have to clearly put it on the table in order to split work among yourself. For instance, in my case, my technical co-founder is my CTO is purely technology oriented. So all he can do is do technology. He can program, he can code, he can come out with best processes in technology. But when it comes to me, I am totally into business. So it's very essential to discuss. Like, all this happened because I have discussed my strengths. I've given him a clearer picture, saying that my strength is business, strategizing, setting up a system. So all I can do is this. And at times, you might think, like, why is it essential to discuss? Like, we clearly know that he is technical and I'm into business, I can work straight away. It's essential this way because sometimes some expertise of ours or some interest which we have or which we have acquired over a period of time will actually enhance their process. For instance, I'm good at teaming things up. So we have a technical team now, which is actually, which was initially led by me, although he gives the technical ideas and technical time frame for the process. I'll be the one who will be following things up with them. But with time, I have nurtured that in my technical co-founder as well. But it is essential to collaborate that way, which will actually enhance the process. If I never spoke this about this with him, he would have tried all on his own, and it would have taken much of our time, and we would have we wouldn't have ended up saving much on our resources. So every time we should be able to plot our strengths and weaknesses in order to collaborate best, in order to work as a team, in order to enhance the work rate, and also to diversify the processes. Like, you will have a clearer setup and system and a structure for the whole process that is happening, and you can diversify the process to enhance the whole system. So collaboration is an essential trait. And you should be in a position to own things. Like, you should take the responsibility of all the decisions which you make. And because it's, after all, you have calculated things up, you have had your own set of predictions, you have had your own set of approximations. So you should be in a position to take responsibility. Again, owning and taking responsibility and decision making goes hand in hand. And all the previous traits will enable you to be responsible for what you're doing or the decision which you make. So being responsible is again an essential trait. Right. Now I'll just walk you through a set of stats. I'm glad that you're keeping track of my presentation. Right. I wish to walk you through a few facts. Right. I'll try to share this link with you. Actually, it's pretty much supportive. So I'm just going to give you an idea about a few facts. So it's very much interesting that Uganda, an African nation, is most entrepreneurial. Like, it tops the list of most entrepreneurial countries. Like, the entrepreneurs per capita is the highest in Uganda. And I was even surprised to know that in developing countries, the sense of entrepreneurial spirit is higher compared to other nations. And so when it came to entrepreneurship, a desirable career choice, Guatemala, 95.62% of Guatemala was interested that way. And when it comes to Botswana, in the next 3 years, he wanted to start a business. The number of individuals, it was like 61.85%. And top three economies, if you see, the US, only 4.1% of the population is involved in entrepreneurship. China, only 3.12%. And And Japan, it ranked fourth least entrepreneurial country, while the nations of Africa, they were comparatively more interested in pursuing entrepreneurship. And 95.1% have bachelor degrees, 47% of have advanced degrees. Less than 1% come from extremely rich or extremely poor backgrounds. So the thing is that 99% of the people who are from our kind of background, like you are in a more probable population in pursuing your entrepreneurial journey. And 51.9% were first in their family to launch a business. So it's like almost 50-50 of the entrepreneurs have come out from, like, they are self-made entrepreneurs. Like, they have pursued business as first generation. So I could see, like, most of you had this question of the risk which you would be taking towards the entrepreneurial journey. So this is actually exaggerated. This is why they have taken into account much of the developed countries. But when it comes to a startup life, I started my startup life with zero money. Like, I didn't have, I couldn't take any money out of my business because I was just getting started. And average working hours, this is, I guess this stats is just limited to US. When it comes to me, the average time I spend on working as an entrepreneur is close to 80 hours a week. I spend close to 12 hours a day. So that's like 784 hours a week. So 84 hours a week I'll be spending on my entrepreneurial journey. 36% started during studies. So you being still in college, you have a better possibility of starting off. And one other thing which I wish to discuss is you, I'd suggest you work in a startup to understand things better, because in a startup you will be forced to become versatile. All these entrepreneurial trades will be nurtured best in a startup. So it's better to start work in a startup. So I guess you had a good time, and I'm open to questions now. Let's have a Q&A. All right. I'll just give you a picture about the previous session's questions. Like, one question was about the risk, the kind of risk which one should take towards pursuing their entrepreneurial journey. All it takes is just you and your idea. That is the primary point. That is the risk all you take. You should be having an idea. You should have given enough thoughts about your idea. And all you have to do is just get ahead with a particular idea, nurture your idea, explore it. And the idea will take you through the process. So the risk involved is your idea and the thought process which is involved in the whole idea thing. So one other question which I could make out was your question on AgriTech. AgriTech has a wide scope. The dependent technologies that are being worked on with regards to Agri is, number one, hybrid engineering, the biotechnological engineering and bioinformatic engineering that is being worked on. The technology that is being used includes artificial intelligence, blockchain, and other potential technologies will include improvising the current processes through different technologies that will include automation, IoT, which is being worked widespread. So if there is a group of people who are involved in the process of, who are into the domain of agri-tech and information technology, you can actually have a cross-domain work within the institute itself. Like you can make fullest use of the resources, and I'll be happier to have more questions. I guess you're done with the questions for the day. Anyways, I take this opportunity to thank St. Eugene's University, Zambia, and St. John the Baptist University, Malawi, for giving me this opportunity. And I thank Mr. Anthony for the opportunity given. Thank you.
Dear participants, Mr. Tony has given the wonderful presentation about the entrepreneurship rights. I hope you are got more explanations. So if you have any query, shoot out your questions in the chat box. He's ready to answer the questions.
Yes, you got really tired with my session, I guess. Anyways, you can shoot out your questions anytime. Like, we might have some group or a Facebook page on which we'll be having process discussion and system discussion over a period of time. So,
Mr. Tony, we didn't receive any of the question from the participants. Yeah. I hope that futurely they're going to be send the question to us. We can answer in future. So if you have any queries related to the topic, kindly send to us. We will clarify based on your questions. Thank you so much, Mr. Tony. You've given the very wonderful information about entrepreneurship rights. Thank you so much. And thank you so much, participants, your patience. Tomorrow we will see again the same time. I mean, Monday. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.